Hey guys, so this video is going to focus on how to determine when a rational expression is undefined and then to state the domain of it. Okay, so if we're talking about rational expressions, we're talking about pretty much anything that could be written in fraction form. The only difference, instead of having, you know, a regular fraction like maybe 2/3, we're dealing with fractions where you have a polynomial in the numerator and denominator, right? So you have, you know, binomials, trinomials, maybe something even more. So if we're dealing with rational expressions that look like this, specifically talking about what is going to make them undefined. Now, I always say rational expressions are exactly the same, or they follow the exact same rules as regular fractions, fractions that just have numbers in them. So if we're thinking about a regular fraction, so a regular fraction is undefined when the denominator equals zero. So you might have seen this property before, right? Anything over zero is undefined. So you might have seen it in something like 5 divided by 0. And the most common mistake or the most common wrong answer for this one here is to say that this is 0. But it's actually not 0. Anytime you divide by 0, it is undefined. So if a fraction is undefined when the denominator equals 0, well, a rational expression is undefined when the denominator equals 0. So what we need to do to determine if a rational expression is undefined, what we need to do is we need to figure out, well, hey, what's going to make that denominator equal zero? So this is what we do. You take the denominator. So the one step for this problem is this. Take the denominator and set it equal to zero and solve it. So my denominator here is x squared minus x minus 6. For these particular examples here, we don't care what the numerator is. That plays no part whatsoever into this example here, this type of problem. We only care about the denominator. My denominator for this problem is this trinomial right here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to set it equal to zero and I'm going to solve this thing. Now, do be careful when it comes to solving this here. So depending on what your denominator looks like, sometimes you may be able to use your steps of solving an equation, you know, get the x by itself, what you do to one side, you do to the other side, and you may be able to solve it that way. But anytime you have this little squared here, anytime you're dealing with a quadratic equation here, and that's what we have here, anytime you have a quadratic equation, you have to factor it. So I can't just go about solving this thing and like plus six or something like that. It's not gonna work. If you have a quadratic equation, you have to factor it. Now, if I have a trinomial here that I have to factor, I'm gonna use what I call reverse FOIL method. So when you have to factor any example, always start by thinking, do I have a greatest common factor in this problem? Now, looking over the example I have here, there is no greatest common factor, so I can go straight to drawing my parentheses and solving this thing. So remember, when we're factoring this here, we always look at the first term, and here I have x squared. The only way to factor x squared is an x times an x. So remember, we're kind of following the FOIL method here, but in reverse. Remember, FOIL stands for first, outside, inside, last. So these first two spots right over here, right, those need to multiply well to get this first spot in my trinomial. So x times x is x squared. Then we move over to last, the L. And that tells me that last times last is going to get me this last right here. So here we have a 6. So what we need to do is we need to think, well, how do I get a 6 when I multiply? And the only way to get a 6 when you multiply, go ahead and list all the possibilities. The only way to get a 6 is 1 times 6 or 2 times 3. Those are the only possibilities. Now, the one we want is we want the combination of numbers that multiply to get 6, but add or subtract to get 1. Right? Whatever your middle term is, they need to add or subtract to get that. So if I need my numbers to add or subtract to get a 1, that means I want the 2 and the 3, since 3 minus 2 is a 1. And I'm just going to fit them in right here. Honestly, it doesn't matter where they go. What's most important is our next step here. What signs go in front of these here? Do I put pluses or minuses? All right, so always start by using this one rule here. Whatever sign your middle term has, the bigger number must have it. Okay, so let me repeat that. Whatever sign your middle term has, the bigger number must have it. So since my middle term is negative, that means the negative has to go with the 3, since the 3 is bigger than 2. Then what we do is we move over to our last term here. My last term is a negative 6. So I need to think, how do I multiply and get a negative 6? Well, first step back and think about your integer rules when it comes to multiplying here. When you multiply, if they have the same sign, you get a positive answer. A different sign gives you negative answers. Well, we have a negative here, right? So the only way to get a negative is if I have different signs. And since this one, since the 3 is already negative and I have to have different signs, that means this 2 has to be positive. And go back and check this here. A positive 2 times a negative 3 is a negative 6. And 2 minus a 3 is a negative 1. So go back and check that. Make sure they multiply to get this last number. They need to add to get the middle number. And everything checks out here. Now, after we're done with this here, this is our factoring. But remember, we need to solve this thing, right? So if we need to solve this thing, what we do next is we use the zero factor property, which tells us, hey, let's split these two factors up. Let's separate them. And we're going to set each one of these equal to 0. Now, this is what that's going to look like. We're going to take our first factor, which here we have an x plus 2, and we're going to set that equal to 0. And then we're going to take our second factor, which we have x minus 3, and we're going to set that one also equal to 0. Split up the two factors, set them each equal to 0, and solve these two equations. Now, most of the time, these are going to be one or two step equations here that you're going to solve. They shouldn't be that difficult here. So now we can use our solving equation steps here to finish this out. Starting with the equation here on the left, all I have to do is subtract 2 on both sides. That's going to cancel, and I get that x is a negative 2. This equation on the right, so I'm going to add 3 to both sides, and I get that x is equal to 3. So my two solutions here are negative 2 and a 3. A negative 2 and a 3 is what would make my denominator equal 0, therefore making my rational expression undefined. So if all you're asked is what values make the rational expression undefined, well, negative 2 and 3. If you're asked to also state the domain of it, so your domain, essentially in a nutshell, your domain is the span of all your x values here. So if you're looking at a graph, maybe, right? And let's just pretend here I have a graph maybe that looks like this. Your domain is how far out on your x-axis here does your graph exist? Now, if I have a graph that looks like this, I know that this is going to be going on and on and on forever. So for this particular graph, it would be a negative infinity to infinity. But when we're solving here and we're finding these specific values, that means my graph doesn't exist at those two values there. So like, for example, you might have a hole at negative 2 and then a hole at 3, right? So that's the only two spots where your graph doesn't exist. Everywhere else it does. So the way that you can state that is by saying this here. So our domain is all x values, everything on the x-axis, everything from negative infinity to positive infinity, except when x is equal to negative 2 and 3. So this is one way that you can state your domain here. Another way that you can do it is using interval notation. You can say that my domain exists from negative infinity all the way to negative 2, and then it's going to go from negative 2 to 3, and then it's going to go from 3 to positive infinity. So maybe thinking about a number line here where you have a negative 2 and a 3, where you have a hole at those two numbers, but your graph exists everywhere else. That's what this is telling you here. So our domain is everything except for negative 2 and 3. So think about what that would look like on a graph or on a number line. And your answer is everything except for those two. So either ax, as long as x is not negative 2 and 3, or you can do interval notation and show it that way as well. Okay, so otherwise, set your denominator equal to 0 and solve, and those are the values when your rational expression is undefined.